All right.
All right. Well, it is 7:30. We are going to call to order this fine morning. I'll start by roll call. Andy Franklin.
Here.
And Molly Krychowiak is here. So we're all here. Next is approval of the agenda. Is there a motion?
So moved.
I'll second that, and we'll do a voice vote. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Excellent. Next, we're moving on to new business, and item 2A is the Director of Pupil Services.
Mm-hmm. So we are pretty excited that we have a recommendation for hire, and she, you know, pending board approval and contract approval and all these things that need to happen in the next couple of weeks, accepted our offer. So we're pretty excited about that. So I just wanted to walk you through a little bit of the process so that you two would have that background. I'm anticipating I would most likely go through the process again on the 20th, but I'll just do the quick version. So let me see if I can share my screen. So I basically just documented each step of the process so that everyone would be sure that this was done with fidelity and people had input and that we went through. So I know you guys received an email a while back with some questions about who the candidates were in WECAN and what we had for a candidate pool. So I won't go into that. But when we got to the first round, ooh, this has people's names on it.
Yeah. I was going to say, wait.
So I could give you some generic stuff. So we did videos and we had, I want to say 15 candidates submit videos. And then we pulled together, I could probably share with you who was, nope, not that one. I could share with you who was on the team though. I think that would be okay. So the interview team included Dr. Rodriguez, Ms. Westfall, Mr. Krager, Mr. Williams, and then also Steve Tilley, Dr. Smith, and Denise. Mia was invited to do a rubric, but some things fell. She just decided that she no longer wanted to. And then I asked Denise to do like 7 or 8. So she just picked up some additional candidates for us. So that was the first round. Everybody was given a rubric. So I can show you the template of that. To fill out for the candidates. So they had their video links across the top. I asked them to watch, and actually we ended up doing 4 instead of 3. Watch all 4 videos. I just randomly assigned them. So each candidate was screened by more than one staff member, but it was a random assignment to each person who they got. And then to use the rubric. So we talked about cultural fit, teamwork, experience, leadership, critical thinking, knowledge of special ed, knowledge of student services, equity, inclusion, and being a strategic thinker. So they were ranked 1 through 5, and then everybody was able to give some notes too and just some general feedback on each candidate. So out of that process, there was a pretty clear 6. So I just took all the rubrics, averaged all the scores, had a rubric with each candidate's name in there, put their total, their average, and 6 really floated to the top. So that was our first round. So then that moved us to the second round. Come on, computer. Sorry, something just popped up. So round 2 was humans coming in and a big team and bringing in the 6 candidates. We had some interview questions that were a collaborative effort. I sent the questions out to the team. So basically I emailed the student services team, all special ed teachers, and said, I would really like to have, like, I want our school psych there because there's only one of her, right? I'd love to have the student services team there. And I'd love to have a couple special ed teachers at least from each building there. So that was my ask. And I sent it out to all staff. So then when we got to the interviews, and of course, Kayla being the secretary in that department. So let's see if I can do. All right. So get rid of the candidate names again. So this was our interview team. So we had Kayla, we had 4K special ed teacher, we had speech and language from Parkway, Denise, myself, obviously, a special ed teacher from Glen Hills, Tilly, Dr. Rodriguez, and Renee Sladek. So we had a really nice cross-section, special education, student services, both buildings. So once people volunteered, I then sent out a request for interview questions. They sent questions in. I used banks of questions that I already have, but then everybody had some input. Like we had some specific questions to early childhood, to early intervening services that came from that 4K lens. We had some questions around equity. We had some questions around student services and special ed. So we just went through the standard interview process with each candidate. After round two, after each candidate, we stopped, we did strengths, we did wonderings. So I have a whole chart of that information as well. And then I sent them on their way and asked them to do an anonymous scoring because I didn't want, sometimes when you're in a room and you're talking, you could have a candidate that you really felt strongly about, but if half the team says, oh, yuck, you're gonna feel some pressure around that. So I wanted to make sure everybody had an opportunity to really rank on the candidate. So I'm gonna do this really fast. So they ranked each candidate 1 through 6. And after that, again, 3 floated to the top. We actually had one candidate who ranked only as a 1 or 2 with the entire team as a 1st or 2nd choice. And then 2 candidates that also had some 1st and 2nd choice rankings. The other 3 didn't have any 1st or 2nd. So that's what determined our 3rd round. Round 3 was the entire administrative team. So we brought them back in for interviews. We did strengths and wonderings. We did some debriefing. We really looked at what our district needs are because we had 2 candidates that really rose to the top at the end of that last round. And we really just looked at experience, district needs, where are we, what systems do we need in place? What are we, as far as structure, as far as supports, what training needs do we have, and who is the candidate with more of that experience? And so then that led me to the final recommendation. And also really talking with teaching and learning and, because we really want that to be a partnership so that we don't have special education student services in a silo so that it's all connected. So we're really excited about our recommendation and she accepted the offer. We obviously let her know that we're still working on some administrative contract pieces. So we'll go through that process with the board first before we even we write up a contract that we would then bring on the 20th. So that's where we are with that.
All right, any questions?
No, so I guess at this point you're asking us to do letter of intent, but the letter of intent doesn't fill in any blanks and really just would be a committee's acknowledgement that we're in this process. So
it's a kind of a goodwill, hey, we said we were offering you the job, we really meant it. Mm-hmm. It's just sort of that gesture as well.
Okay. Well, the only other observation to make is that it really does seem like this was a very thorough process here the time frame that you did it. So I'm excited that we're going to get someone in, and I really am impressed by all the steps that we went through.
And it's something that I've always done just because you really want to make sure you're bringing people in, you're really transparent, you're collecting everybody's thoughts, everybody's feedback, so that when you get to a recommendation, you can really fall back on all of that information and reasoning.
Okay.
Well, as someone who is going to indirectly reap the benefits of this new hire, thanks for doing all that you did to find a quality candidate. I appreciate that.
Yeah, we talked about transition.
Okay. Are you going to attend any of those meetings? This is totally off topic, but will you be at some of those?
So I know that Mr. Williams is planning to attend all the meetings because we've sort of transitioned to him being the LEA on a lot of the schools. I was going to honestly just look at the list and see if there were any I thought I should perhaps insert myself in.
All right. Sorry for the tangent, everybody. All right. Well, thank you for that. So item B is summer school and athletic director.
Well, actually, do we need to take then a vote on, we need to make a motion though on the request.
It's
actually not listed in here. It's letter of intent. So I just want to double check that. So we have that letter of intent. We actually don't have any further action here.
I guess if you guys are okay with the letter of intent.
Well, to support the recommendation. Okay. Well, I mean, to make it clear, I support the letter going out. Okay. If you think we need to do a formal motion, I can do a formal motion.
I don't feel we need to.
All right, then. Enough said.
All right. Okay, let's move on to summer school and athletic director. This is director, and this is a discussion item.
Yes. So we just wanted to circle back. I know we had talked about moving forward if we want those positions to stay the way they currently are, where they're connected to a specific person, or if we want it to them to be posted position. This could be two, these aren't lumped together. So it could really be like we're feeling this way about one and this way about the other. But as we're looking at posting positions and things for next year, we just wanted to bring it back to the conversation and looking at contracts.
Well, what is our policy? Because I mean, my experience is that when there's summer school positions or, I mean, I don't know, what is our policy about that? If I feel like every year it's just assumed it's the same person. And do we want that? And do we want to, I don't know, what is, do we have a policy in regards to these two positions anywhere?
I couldn't find anything, but I don't know if there's maybe a different place to look. It just seems like historically it's just kind of been the same people.
Yeah, it's a historic thing.
Yeah, I think that's what I would say, although I don't know how things got muddled with the respect to summer academy. I don't know how formalized that's been in the last couple of years with Dr. Smith, but with athletic director, I think that the title itself was something that as we were going through things over the last couple of years, finding out that title was formal and that it carried with it a position was a surprise to us. And I would like to have that, addressed in the policy in terms of how we select that. And even if we're not going to change anything with respect to Summer Academy, it's a good idea to have these things documented. We're doing policy work now. So I think that's a good idea. And create a policy about those.
Go ahead, Allison.
I was just going to say Summer Academy would be planning for summer of 23. Like there's nothing that would change. Obviously, no. We're full-fledged planning right now. But it's really that athletic director that I guess would be a more timely conversation as we look to post for positions for next year.
Well, and in regards to these two positions, I'm wondering if, and I know this kicks back to policy, but is there a formal review at the end? Is there, are they assessed on how they did during their current position or the year before? I just think there needs to be something in place because this is an additional duty, an additional job. And I feel as though, they should be assessed on that, but also other people might want to have the opportunity to take on that leadership position.
Okay. So I'm hearing kind of send it to policy and see if we can dig and see if we can find anything else on that.
Yeah, that's my recommendation. Andy, are you?
I concur. I think it's a good process. I think policy's got to decide how they want to do that. And you're right. These things need to have some kind of evaluation with it. But we need to understand what that process is going to be. I mean, I'd like Mr. Birmingham. I'd like Dr. Smith. I'm not in any way, casting aspersions. I don't think Molly is either. But it's good just that people understand that these things work to have a policy that guides.
Okay. Sounds good.
Okay, so then moving on to item C, and that is staff recommendations.
All right, so while we have not formalized the strategic plan, we have a lot of information from our staff, from our parents, from our community around areas of focus. We've got some areas of focus identified through the ESSER survey for sure. Of course, around social emotional, and then of course that learning loss piece. So based on those pieces, along with just staffing meetings with principals. So Lindsay and I met with building principals and talked about looking at next year, current needs and where we feel like we have some gaps that we need to fill. So this is not going to be the last staffing for next year, but we're happy to get a start on it this early and this soon. We actually attended a job fair on Saturday. And it was amazing because we were able to tell CESA some of the positions we might be looking for. And then candidates saw those lists. And so we had counselors and psychologists and people coming to talk to us, excited about possibly working in our district. So that was a great opportunity. We have a stack of resumes. So we're hoping that, you know, that's a head start on some of this. But one of the needs that was identified through our staffing meetings with Glen Hills was to add an additional counselor. We're working through, obviously, you know, some scheduling things, some structural things. How's that going to look next year? How are we going to utilize staff to meet kids' needs, especially coming out of COVID? So the feeling from the building, which I totally agree with, is that we need to be able to focus on academics and on SEL. And so to have two counselors to do that would be ideal. They could split it different ways. They could specialize, they could split by grade levels. That's obviously to be determined, but we know that we want to add an additional counselor to Glen Hill. So that's one. The other one is a school psychologist, to add an additional psychologist. The number of referrals right now that Dr. Rodriguez is dealing with, and it's not stopping. And I don't see it. I don't see us getting ahead of this for a couple years yet with just the early childhood, the speech and language, OT, some of the needs kids are coming with because of pandemic, because they weren't in school or they weren't in daycare, they just weren't socializing. So we're seeing a lot of needs, and then we've already had a lot of needs in our district. So adding a school psychologist, not only for the referrals and the evaluations, but also potentially to see groups and see kids and do some of those things that Dr. Rodriguez just doesn't have the capacity to do right now. One of the things we talked about with that position, and actually I can come back to that, so I'll hold that for a minute. The next one we talked about was coaching and intervention. So right now Glen Hills has only a 0.5 coach interventionist. So we would be looking to increase that to a full-time person, and then adding one reading and one math to Parkway. Again, hitting that early intervention so that hopefully we don't get in this situation where we've got middle schoolers who are still in need of intervention or special education, because we've been able to really hit it at that 4K through 3 and fill those gaps early. And then also a special ed teacher at Parkway, and that's just based on working with the Parkway team, determining how we're going to place students so that we can provide more inclusive practices. We really want to work with staff on specially designed instruction, appropriate accommodations and supports, and inclusive practices. And so if we're going to have this big ask of staff, we need to make sure that we're giving them support so that a teacher isn't trying to support 3 and 4 classrooms, because then they can't do it well. So we really looked at how many classrooms can a teacher support? How many will we need at each grade level? How do we divide up kids? So we're really doing some of that work. We're going to even dig down to, you know, each kid, what do they have for reading minutes? What do they have for math minutes? How do we place them so that teachers can really co-plan, co-serve together with the regular ed teacher? So in order to do that well at Parkway, we need to add one special education teacher. All of that said, that would be a 5.5 FTE. We do, however, have a reduction in 2 building subs, which would still leave 1 full-time building sub in each building, but reduce 2 building subs. We currently have a coach intervention position that's vacant. It's somebody that accepted the job in the summer and then had some family issues, and we never filled that. And then we're looking at using ESSER for the school psych. Typically, we would not use that for a position, but because we know that we're in a situation where in a year or two, we could be back to 1 school psych, we kind of have that out. You know what I mean? We're not like, we don't have to continue that position if we feel that in a couple of years, we're back in a space where we no longer need 2 school psychologists. So it would really be a total FTE increase right now of 1.5. We still have to work with Glen Hills around to see what happens with the scheduling piece. We may need a couple additional teachers there, depending on how that shakes out. And we still have to do paraprofessionals. But right now, we're just asking for that 1.5. And I don't know if you have any questions about any of that before Jenica was going to just talk a little bit more about the coach intervention piece.
No, my question is actually related to the coach and intervention piece. So I don't have any other questions in regards to, the coach intervention, yeah. It's at Glen Hills, it's moving from a 0.5 to a full-time. Is that what you're saying? Okay. All right. Andy, do you have any questions?
No, not at this time. The only thing I'd ask is if you could chart it out before the meeting.
Just the ads.
Visualize, yeah.
Sure.
Yeah, well, isn't that usually helpful?
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
So then, Jenica, do you want to go a little bit into the, I know that there's been some questions around what's coaching, what's intervention. So she pulled some information on that.
Sure, I can just share a job description if that works. If I can share my screen. Ooh, I got a lot of stuff up here. Don't look. Let me just slide this over. If I can. So this is just one for Parkway. It's very similar for Glen Hills, just the qualifications. And then we can share this with, you know, everyone as well. So it is kind of, we've kind of laid it out as a split role based on need, because we weren't necessarily sure of, you know, what intervention needs would be for this upcoming school year. So currently we're really heavy on the intervention side versus the coaching side. And we're noticing that we definitely have, you know, additional needs for intervention when looking at the data. So the role is kind of a split role, that there, a lot of them are taking about six groups of students. And then they're also, you know, supporting some of that coaching within the classrooms. The feedback I'm getting is that we're not getting enough coaching and additional support from classroom teachers, both from Parkway and from over here at Glen Hills. So there is that need, you know, to continue to support our teachers with especially new curriculum after going through an ELA curriculum review this year, with new standards and new units that are going to be coming out next year. Some of that coaching support is going to be extremely important. And then we also want to make sure that we are servicing all students who need additional support as well. So I think there's a real need to look closely at this and make sure that we're providing enough support for both our students and for staff. So you can kind of see that it's a split position currently, again, based on student needs because of the staff we have right now.
For the coaching and intervention position at Glen Hills, that's to move to 1.0. Mm-hmm. Is that reading, will that interventionist be in charge of reading and math at that level?
No.
Okay.
No. So currently there is a 1.0, a full FTE for math at Glen Hills.
Got it. Okay.
And there's only a 0.5 for ELA. Yeah.
Thanks for clarifying that.
Yeah. So that kind of brings it up to, you know, a one FTE.
Mm-hmm. And Molly, thank you for clarifying that so that I can be more clear about that as well.
And that ended up happening because we there was a split position where it was 0.5 at Parkway and 0.5 at Glen Hills. Mm-hmm. But the person in that role resigned, and then we weren't able to, you know, after posting, we were not able to fill that with a qualified staff member.
Right. The other question I have is, earlier, Allison, you talked about inclusive practices and co-plan and co-serve. Will the teachers be coached by the group that we're currently working with? Is that where that PD will come through there? And also then, will there be a coach, like a local coach, to help with some of that, like UDI and interventions within the classroom? Do we have someone local to provide coaching for that specifically?
Ironically, we were just talking about that yesterday. So what I see happening is we continue on with Peggy Black for a certain amount of time, but there would be a transition when we bring in the new director, because the new director would then take on some of that part of the role. So right now, like, our last meeting with Peggy Black was around, okay, we need to talk about, what does achievement look like? What is specially designed instruction? Special ed is not a place, you know, all of those pieces. Mm-hmm. And so we're going to start some of that. But of course, we had to spend so much of our time just getting current state, because the audit didn't really give us a lot of deep information. So it's been talking to teachers and talking to teams and getting to a point now where we're like, okay, here's the work we need to do, which actually is kind of a nice transition, because then when we interviewed, we talked a lot about that, which is what led us to the candidate that it led us to, because they have experience with that. So I see a transition Lindsay and I were just talking about that yesterday. Obviously, we would come to the board with that because Peggy's contract, I believe, is through this school year. So if we were looking to keep her on for like a semester or the next school year, we would obviously bring that to the board. But we have a new, the new director would start in July. So we have some time to talk about that. I think the coaching intervention piece is so important to the special education piece, because every conversation we have with anybody is about tier one. So how do we ensure that tier one is really strong so that what we're doing with our other students is really on top of and not like replacing tier one pieces. So it's so connected.
Right.
Right. All right. I don't have any other questions. Andy, do you?
No, not this time.
Okay. Thank you. Then item D is an update on teacher contracts.
I'm guessing you got that one, Lindsay, or no?
Yeah, no. So we met with the goals. I was waiting to see if you were going to do an intro. That was all.
No, sorry.
We met with both schools yesterday, Glenhill and Parkway, with teachers, and just outlined the salary schedule and the compensation model that the board approved a few weeks ago. We got great feedback. A lot of people have just really appreciated the transparency and just that we're looking to kind of mainstream things and have something consistent to go back to. I also included a survey just for staff to fill out to complete with feedback, just as, is there more information that we can provide? And so far, it's only been a couple, but it's just been really good. So
awesome.
It went well. And we also just reiterated that we want to get teacher contracts out to them in April.
So. Good. Any questions, Andy?
Nope. I'm good.
I mean, I'm so glad that this is, I'm sure that they appreciate the transparency, and I'm glad that we've moved forward with that. And I'm glad moving forward, there's a consistent, this is when you're getting a contract. I mean, I'm glad that this is being cleaned up for the sake of our teachers and our district administrators too. All right. Well, then we'll move on to visitor participation. Is there anyone from the visitors that would like to participate? All right, that being said, I would like to entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
And I'll second that. Voice vote, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. I just want to say that this has been my favorite committee of all the committees I've been working on. I've loved the early start time, and I like that our meetings are concise and to the point. So thank you very much.